Cordial welcome to all of you watching this from the Heartfulness Wellness Webinars. I am Dr. Neeta Deshpande. I'm based out of Belgaum. I am a diabetologist, endocrinologist, and a bariatric physician in practice for the last 25 years. So today we are going to talk about a very chronic metabolic disease, and that is diabetes. We all know that today there are about 73 million diabetics in India, and it's very likely that one in four people could be having some kind of a dysglycemia, that is disordered glycemic response or disordered sugars, which means to say that this encompasses people who are actually diagnosed with diabetes and those who are on the border, that is pre-diabetic. So that is one in four. So this is a very large number, and this is a chronic disease. So that's why we are going to be talking about what type 2 diabetes can do to our lives, how best we can live with it, because as of today, largely, it is a disease that cannot be cured, but can be controlled very well. Well, in the last few years or in the last decade, technology research has gone ahead by leaps and bounds. We have far more drugs than ever before today to treat diabetes. We have different technological devices that can treat diabetes. However, the progress in terms of outcomes has not been in tandem, in the sense that our HbA1c, which is basically the measure of the diabetic control, that is HbA1c, that has not improved. It is seen globally that at least 30% of people who can actually come to an HbA1c, that is a dream target, and the rest of them are not, despite all the technology and all the advances that have happened. So what is it that we are missing here? And that is what we are going to explore in today's webinar, and find out what is it that is missing. What is the missing link that precludes good diabetic control? Because all of us know, if diabetes is not well controlled, it spawns a whole lot of other diseases in terms of complications such as heart attacks, kidney disease, eye disease, etc. So to take us through their journeys, we have people from both sides of the table. So we have a doctor on one side to talk to us about this. And on the other side, we have people with type 1 and type 2 diabetes. All of you know the difference. Type 1 diabetes is a different disease from type 2 diabetes, where type 1 is a childhood disease that is dependent on insulin injections for survival throughout life. And type 2 disease is in large part a lifestyle disease that can be controlled very well with medication in terms of insulin, tablets first actually, then if necessary insulin and lifestyle. So they're quite different in terms of the disease profiles. And so we are going to see people from both sides of the table. And for this, we have an eminent group of panelists. First and foremost, from the doctor's side, you have Dr. Ravi Kiran Muthuswamy, who is an endocrinologist at Vadapalani, and he has a special interest in diabetes, thyroid, obesity, and childhood hormonal disorders. And he has published widely and authored chapters in textbooks and is a member of various societies for diabetes. So we have with us Dr. Ravi Kiran, who is going to take us through and is one of our panelists. Next, we have Mr. V.K. Somkumar, who is an industrialist into textile processing and environmental consultancy, and also manufactures a variety of equipment. So we have him as a representative, as a prototype of a person who has successfully conquered type 2 diabetes. And last but not the least, we have Jazz Sethi with us, a young dynamic girl who is the founder and director of the Diabetes Foundation, a global movement to make those with type 1 diabetes feel heard, understood, supported, and celebrated. I'm not going to tell you too much about her story because I want it to come from her, but suffice it to say here that she is inspirational. She is a professional dancer, choreographer, theater artist, and a published author. With these few words, I'm going to straight away begin this panel discussion that we have today. And as I said, we are going to have people from both sides of the table from a doctor's office. Before I proceed, let me tell you that today the terminology for diabetes patients is not diabetics. It is persons with diabetes, because diabetes is considered a state and not a disease. If inadvertently I refer to them as diabetics, it's a mistake on my part because it's years of using that terminology, and I'm sorry for that. But I want to clear it right here that we have to make an attempt to say persons with diabetes, because they are persons first and diabetics later. So it's persons with diabetes. So inadvertently, if I use the wrong terminology, please forgive me for that. So let me begin first and foremost with Dr. Ravi Kiran. I'm going to ask him a question. Okay. Dr. Ravi Kiran, what's the toughest challenge that you face when you are dealing with a person with type 2 diabetes, especially when it comes to adherence to diet, adherence to medication? So what is the toughest challenge that you face? Before that, I request the persons who are not speaking to please mute themselves.
Hi. Thank you for the kind introduction. Dear panelists, thanks for this chance to interact with you all through this webinar. As Dr. Neeta alluded to, diabetes is a lifelong condition. It is an issue. It takes some time for people with diabetes to come to terms with it. The demands put forth by the disease or the condition and the commitment expected by the healthcare personnel, including doctors, from the people with diabetes. In addition to stress being the background problem for precipitating the condition of diabetes, the very thought of something that is going to live with you for life, and the thought that you are going to commit some time and effort to keep it under control, that itself adds stress to the life of patients with the people with diabetes. So I think these two are the major challenges when so many medicines, even though so many medicines are available, even though people know that a little bit of exercise, a little bit of diet control is going to help you a long way, still the thought of some condition going to extend throughout your life and you are having to commit to some effort and time to keep it under control throughout your life, that definitely is stressful. So the first duty of the doctor or the healthcare personnel treating that person consists in reassuring the person that it is not so hard, but it is fairly easy to cope with it. So this reassurance has to come from everyone, the doctor, the parents of a young child with diabetes, or sons and daughters of an elderly person with diabetes. So that person needs it from every source possibly. So that is the biggest challenge for a doctor, of convincing the person with diabetes to stay on course, even though it is going to be a lifelong marathon rather than a sprint, and reassuring him that the efforts needed and commitment needed is not so hard to put in. It's fairly easy to deal with. That's the initial biggest challenge for the person treating a person with diabetes.
Yes, Dr. Ravi, and I would definitely add to that. In my last 25 years of seeing these diabetes patients, you find that adherence to diet, adherence to lifestyle, adherence to medication, adherence to monitoring, checking continuously, that kind of gets to them. And after a while, a kind of a fatigue sets in. So
true.
Is something that one needs to fight. And that is the most difficult part. And that's why we have so many adherence issues, like in any other chronic disease. I would like to now turn to Mr. Som Kumar, who has type 2 diabetes or had type 2 diabetes. We're going to hear about his story very soon. And what I would like to know from you, Mr. Som Kumar, is when were you first diagnosed and what was your journey like in the first 3 years of the disease? After you were diagnosed, what did you feel and what did you do in the first 3 to 4 years of the disease? We'll come to the latter part later, but the first 3-4 years is what I'm interested in. You are muted, Mr. Som Kumar.
I think it was about 14, 15 years back. I was diagnosed as a person with diabetes. I correct my normal coining of the word. And the immediate reaction was I was shocked because I never expected that this kind of a disease will capture me. Because I was into athletics, I was into fitness for quite a number of years. So I thought this disease is not for me, for somebody else. So it was a shock. And this shock continued for at least 2-3 months. And then I understood that, you know, I cannot just live like that with all these apprehensions, with all the fears. So I must challenge. I must take a challenge.
So did it come as a shock to you because you had no family history as a...
Yes, I had my uncles. My uncles had, not my father or mother.
Right.
So I thought it is a distant thing for me. That is how I took it in the beginning, because I was not into the disease, into the intricacies of the disease, since I didn't have it in the close family.
Right.
So then I thought, you know, let me know about the disease. So I started reading books on it, you know, asking doctors about what it is, and slowly gathering information about it. This was actually for maybe for 1 year or 1.5 years, I was into this process of getting more knowledge about the disease. Then I got a clue that in one of the books, that for type 2 diabetes, if you build your muscle mass and release your fat, that will help you a lot because muscle cells will consume more sugar. So this was my first step into handling the disease. So maybe for the first 3 years, I started going into this particular routine. I joined a gym and started working again.
Right.
I was 60 at that point of time, 60 years. So in younger days, I was going to gym and all, but later on, I stopped it. When I got this clue that it is the only way for you to handle the disease and challenge it, I started going to the gym again, started doing yoga and all. And it's a long story. The remaining part of it, I'll tell you in the next part of the session.
So you were coping with it by gathering enough knowledge from the right sources.
Yes.
And so that's very important in this kind of a disease, to have the right kind of knowledge from the right resources.
Yes.
And trying to cope with it. So
yes.
Right from the beginning, you were trying to take charge of the disease yourself. So that's a very...
In fact, I wanted to challenge it. That's my nature normally. If I am put into a negative situation,
yes,
for a few days, I'll just be captured by that situation.
Right.
After that, I'm ready to challenge it.
Yeah. So you take the bull by the horns and deal with it head on.
Yes. Yes.
That's a nice way to do it, actually. And so in the first 2-3 years, it was actually a knowledge finding and then trying to deal with it.
Yes.
Okay. So were you able to deal with it well enough in those
few years? Yes, reasonably well during the first 3 years and all. Then after that, it improved. There are so many other things came into my life, which will be very handy to handle the disease.
Handle the disease.
Yes.
Now, I'll turn my attention to Jaz Sethi, who is, as I told you, a very dynamic personality. And she has type 1 diabetes. Type 1 diabetes is an autoimmune disease, basically, which destroys the insulin producing cells in the pancreas, and they can never be regenerated. So it essentially means that a person with type 1 diabetes cannot survive without insulin injections every day, or insulin getting into the body from outside in some other way. So it's not a very nice diagnosis to have. Yes, and it can be quite devastating. So I'm going to turn to Jaz and ask Jaz, how old were you when you were actually told that you have type 1 diabetes? And what is your earliest memory of your emotional state or the feeling when you were told that you have this particular disease?
Thank you so much, firstly, for the invitation for this webinar. And thank you, Dr. Neeta, for that wonderful introduction. I was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes when I was 13 years old, on 2009. And I remember losing a lot of weight the week prior. I had lost about 7 kgs in a week. I was drinking lots of water. I was going to the bathroom every 5 minutes. And so we just basically asked the family doctor, like normal Indian parents would, to say what to do. And he just said, get a blood test done, get a urine test done. And the result sort of came to my family doctor itself, and he just called up my father and mother and said, take her to the hospital immediately. And when we went to the emergency room, I was extremely dehydrated and stuff like that. And they checked my sugar over there and they said it's a 1,050 milligrams per deciliter.
Wow.
And they were shocked. They were like, you should be in a coma right now. And for a 13-year-old to hear all of this, not know what's happening, was very scary, I would say, to say the least. I was immediately admitted and stuff like that. But in my head, going to a hospital meant that once you're discharged, you're going to be okay.
Right.
That was the normal sort of train of thought for me. When my endocrinologist came and told me that I have type 1 diabetes, for me, it was like, theek ho jayega once I leave the hospital. Only then later on, when he sort of sat me down and explained to me what this entailed, I had to take insulin for the rest of my life. This was not going to go away. There was no cause. There was no cure. All these things were not really digestible to me for the first couple of years. It kept thinking like it was going to get okay. Only much later did I realize that it wasn't, and it was going to be with me throughout the rest of my life. And that sort of acceptance took a while. It took a couple of years. But then it sort of made me the person I am, where I found my purpose in my diabetes. I found my purpose in getting more people aware, getting more people educated, focusing on peer support, which is why I started the Diabesties Foundation. But I do remember that the day I was diagnosed with type 1, and they told my parents first, and the first thing my father came in and told me was, okay, you have type 1 diabetes, but even Waseem Akram has it, and he's a world-class athlete, so don't worry. So that's the earliest memory I have.
Earliest memory you have. But it hadn't really sunk in, as you said, as to what is going to entail for the rest of your life. Not at that time. You were just 13, right?
Absolutely. Okay.
Right, right. So let me turn again to the doctor side of the table. Dr. Ravi Kiran, we all have busy practices. We see so many patients in a day. And you as an endocrinologist are also dealing with thyroid and so many other diseases. But when it comes to a chronic disease like type 2 diabetes or type 1 diabetes, how much emphasis would you lay on the empathy factor, the doctor being empathetic towards the patient in this kind of a situation? Do we really have the time for it? And should we be making the time for it? And what is its role?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. Very pertinent to a doctor treating a chronic disorder like diabetes or rheumatic or asthma. Because it's not like a surgery where surgery is done for 3 days, then the surgeon may never get to see the patient again for 2 years. Here we are going to see the person every 3 months or 6 months. We are going to be in touch with each other. So that by the end of 2 years or 3 years, they almost become like extended family. A good relation develops, a cordial relation develops. Initially, I think all of us as young physicians, we are equipped with technical excellence. We know the right drug to write for a particular condition. So many times when we come out from college and after our initial training with full enthusiasm, most of us set out with a narrow vision thinking that you write 5 medicines and the patient is going to be all right and run off. It's not the case, actually. So I think it's evolution for the physicians, treating physicians also, in terms of learning about human interaction, life in general, and how to deal with people in anxiety, people in stress. Those people have to come in again and again to us, yet may never find a cure in the usual sense of the term. It's a control most of the chronic diseases can be offered in the present state of scientific advancement. It's not a cure yet. So there is some anxiety and stress on the part of patients also. So it is not enough that a doctor has a narrow idea that simply writing the best drug and simply prescribing the most appropriate test is going to saturate everything. Eventually, there has to be a cordial relation between the person with a chronic disease and the treating physician. The person with a particular chronic disease receives his succor and sympathy and support, moral and emotional support, partly from the physician also. So the physician has to empathize for the person's condition, that he has to manage his life, he has to earn his money, he has to do his business. 8 hours, 12 hours, it's going to consume. and he has to spend time with his family. On top of it, he has to commit extra physical activity, some discipline in diet, and some time to spend with his medicines, injection, all these things. So the physician eventually has to come to terms with all these things and has to empathize. This empathy goes a long way in assuring that the person with diabetes or some other chronic disease doesn't feel left alone. He feels that there is this human being who is going to come with me through life, at least for the major part of the life, and make sure that this is going to be a smooth pathway. So empathy is very, very crucial for a physician to develop, especially in dealing with a person with a chronic health condition.
Right. So what you're also saying is that as specialists and super specialists, we tend to look at the patient in a piecemeal fashion and you know, just give advice for the physical part of it, whereas a chronic condition like diabetes requires a much more holistic approach and overall approach, and therein lies the empathy. And we have to understand if the patient is not adherent at some time that he goes through a lot of angst and a lot of problems, and we need to empathize with that. That's so very true. So, Mr. Somkumar, coming back to you, we heard from you that in the first few years you gathered a lot of knowledge about diabetes, went to the gym, you read about the muscle part of it, which is very true. Insulin resistance comes down nicely if you're able to build muscle. But as time went by, did you decide to do anything further about this? Did you think about it a lot? And how did you actually, try to reverse what was happening inside your body? What was your thought process? And how did you go about it?
It was a continuous attempt to gather more information about the disease and about the corrections that I have to make in my life also. And like Das was telling, Wasim Akram was one of my inspirations. So I note all such news, you know, whichever comes in the newspaper and which is actually contributing to my confidence, I note it and keep it in my mind. I heard that he goes, after every session, he goes to the dressing room and have a shot of insulin and comes back and bows. Yeah. So then I thought, no, this is possible.
Role models are very important.
Then I thought this is possible. If he can do it with the insulin injection and all, I'm just beginning. So I can handle it. So that was the first impression I had. Then started correcting the lifestyle, my diet, number one. The whole diet I changed, in fact. I stopped sugar totally.
Right.
And of course, totally in the sense, whenever some temptation comes, I take it. And another thing is, I do regular checking. Every week I check my...
Extremely important.
Yeah, I check my pressure, everything. I used to do that. I bought the instruments at home itself for this purpose. I bought it and kept it. And then slowly what happened is these things were giving me some improvement. But at the same time, there are sometimes, you know, these thoughts come. Suddenly it captures you in the night. You know, I'm into this. What is going to happen to me? How long? And every time, sometimes what happens is, even if you're checking regularly with all this restricted lifestyle, it shoots up. You may not have any reason for it. You know, diabetes is like that. Because so many reasons are there. It's not only diet, it's not only exercise. So then I realized that my mental condition is actually affecting the disease. Right. If I have got some tension next day, if I look at it, you know, the sugar has gone up. So then I thought, you know, what can I do for this? And what actually I'm doing, I was actually doing meditation at that point of time. And the remarkable thing that I found out in meditation is, when you, especially when you start going to gym and all at that age of 60, 65, I'm 74 now. That age, wow, you don't have the energy to cope up with the exercises, the workout that the trainer is giving you.
Right.
So then I thought I must do something like that. At that age, even diet will not give you energy. Something else I have to work on me. So I started gathering information, more information about meditation also. Then I understood that if you really can keep your mind at still by meditation, the energy of the universe comes inside you. And I have experienced it. In the gym itself, I have experienced it. And you can do heavy workout without any problem. I do about 1.5 hours work in the gym even now. And youngsters used to gather around me asking me, "Uncle, how can you do this at this age?" This is the comment that I get from my youngsters who are around me. And I just tell them, showing them that it is not the physical part of it, it is here. I used to tell, show it the heart. Yes. Because I get energy there, I invoke it. There is a process for that. You can do it. is number one. Then again, all these negative feelings, when it comes, meditation helps a lot. So initial part, as I told you, I was gathering information. Second part, I was implementing whatever information I got. Third, even during that period, all positive information I used to gather and keep it in store for me to implement. And finally, the meditation part of it added as a compliment to give energy, to give good feelings, keep your mind still. That was the final touch. And when that also came, now I don't, what I feel now is this disease is a boon for me. That's how I take it. Because I've regulated my lifestyle, my day, my hours. Right. Morning, as I told you, 4 o'clock, I'll get up and till 5, I meditate. Then I go to the gym. Till 7:30, I'm there in the gym, come back. So like that, then all my other work. And it is perfect now. And what I think is, if this disease has not come to me, my life would have been different. I would have messed up with that, you know, with all sorts of unwanted things and things. This is a regulated life you have now, and you're happy with it.
Right. So, yes, Mr. Som Kumar, it is extremely important to recognize that the mind-body connection is very, very strong. If the mind is not at peace, if the mind has no coping skills, then the physical part of it can overcome an individual to a large extent, and everything then becomes a mess, which is very well exemplified in whatever you have said. And you would also be happy to know that there are now controlled studies even in medical literature where meditation has actually brought down the blood sugars, brought down the blood pressure, has been measured. So there is no question about it. And the important thing to understand is that there is a scientific way also to look at meditation. And that is that when you're stressed, your cortisol levels are very high. Cortisol opposes insulin. And when you have something in your body that is stressful and your cortisol levels are going up, your insulin resistance goes up, and consequently your glucose control goes out of hand. So in that sense, I would say that meditation is actually an important part in the armamentarium of therapeutic approaches that we doctors have, and it should be advocated very, very vociferously that it is an important part of life. So
there is one more thing I wanted to tell you.
Yes.
And when you meditate, when the mind is still, if you give a command on anything that you want to do, what want to get done, it works very well from my own experience.
Yes.
And I add this meditation capability to one more thing.
Yes.
See, some of the medicines which I take, it may have its negative effect.
Right.
It may have its negative effect also. I put a thought that none of these medicines are actually giving me any negative effect. And it works also.
That's
so far, so far I don't have any other problem.
That's very nice to hear.
It works actually. I just wanted to tell you because people should know about it.
Yes, of course.
Direct your mind and get certain things which are unbelievable. Actually, you may not think that it will work like that, but it works.
Right. Okay, now turning back, because I'm going to go back and forth between attainment of the journey, attainment of the goal and the journey itself. So I'm going to come back to Jazz, and we have two different age groups, two different diseases over here in the... what I want to ask you is that you have accomplished a lot in such a short time. You have managed to overcome the... So I want to know the process that you went through, how you trained your mind to think this way, and what was it that helped you, what was your support, and how did you did it initially at least interfere in your aspirations and goals to be what you want to be, but basically what I want to know is how you coped with the mental aspect of it. What was the process?
So firstly, I would just very much like to agree with Mr. Som Kumar and you, as you said, about how the status of your mind affects your sugars. So I wear a CGM, I wear a continuous glucose monitor.
Right.
So I see my graph on a daily basis, and the day I'm stressed, the day an incident has happened, you not believe, if I've had a fight with a friend, immediately I see a peak in the graph.
All right.
And I would have not eaten anything and it would be a peak.
Okay.
I remember before my 10th grade exam, my Hindi exam, I was not very good at Hindi, but it was my board exams. I was very nervous before the exam and my sugar shot up to 500. I couldn't give the exam.
So I have seen this throughout my life, and I got my type 1 diagnosis when I was entering adolescence.
Right.
So the hormone changes anyways were going on, and they affected my sugars drastically. I used to have the weirdest fluctuations in one day going from 400 to 40.
Right.
So I think what everyone is advocating for is meditation, more well-being, more calmer state of mind. I'm completely agreeing with that. I think throughout my life, throughout the journey, I have sort of understood how to mentally be more happy to physically be more happy. So right. I know that the techniques that help me, whether it's just some breathing, whether it's taking a walk outside, whether it's listening to music, I don't do it like a practice session, but I do know what helps me throughout. It's talking to a friend. It's just calming my mind, sitting on the balcony. These things help me personally. And I truly believe that diabetes type 1 or type 2 is very, very personal in terms of it. Everyone's treatment is different.
Right.
What works for me may not work for someone else with type 1. And I think to sort of tailor it to yourself is one of the things that I advocate a lot for. As well as you said about the aspirations and goals, I initially did think when I'm a dancer by profession. And I used to have rehearsals every day. And when I was diagnosed, I truly thought that I would have to give up dancing. Only much later again did I realize that things were different, but nothing changed. For example, an 8-hour rehearsal may not have been as easy as it used to be. So I would now probably have to check my sugar in between, take a break, have a snack in the middle. But it didn't change. It was different, but it didn't change.
Okay.
Whether going out with friends, for example, it was different. Now I think my friends carry some of my snacks for me, but it didn't change. So the same way I realized that things may have been different, but that's necessarily not a bad thing. And as long as you're committed in your mind to go ahead and do something, your body will follow. It's mind over matter, as they say. And a lot of my sugars are controlled by my mind, I would like to think. Especially when there are unavoidable situations. Like Mr. Somkumar said, that it's not just diet and exercise.
Yes.
There are so many different factors that affect your sugar, your mood, the temperature, time zones, so many things that we don't even think about.
Yes.
But if we can sort of, there are modifiable aspects and there are unmodifiable aspects. And if we can change some modifiable aspects with a little bit of technique and meditation, then why not?
Yes. So basically, both of you have said the same thing. That you connect with your inner self, find yourself inside, and then you make your mind or your body do whatever you want it to do. So basically, it's a very good coping mechanism to connect with your inner self and then be able to adhere to the diet and the exercise, etc.
Absolutely. Except for making insulin, my mind can tell my body anything.
Yes. Very true. Very true. Well, that was very inspirational, and that was very nice to hear that nothing has really changed and you went on with your this one as usual. So that's really great. So I would like to come back to Dr. Ravi. And I want to ask you, how important do you think is actually meditation? And rather than everyone doesn't meditate, but perhaps a spiritual bent of mind. I'm not talking about religion here. I'm talking about a spiritual bent of mind, which, as I said, allows you to connect with your inner self and talk to yourself. How important is this technique in your patients? And have you seen any patients, do you see a difference in patients who practice it and those who don't?
So after hearing Somakumarji and Jess, it was very revealing how they dealt with and coped with their individual conditions. In the course of my practice, what I found was that, like we all know, medications are important, exercise is important, dieting is important. At the same time, preserving a certain lightness of mind in executing all these things is also important. I read in some meditation-related literature, some Guruji is telling, you play like you work and work like you play. Superficially, it looks like something superfluous. You know, what is this? Some kind of quixotic quote. It's not like that. Then I thought about it deeply. Then it struck me. It is true. When we have a task at hand, when you have something important to do, if we give it more serious thought than it requires, then it backfires. And when you have something important to do, when you attend to it less than what it requires, then again it backfires. So what I found in people doing meditation and also having diabetes and all, most of the people who are doing meditation, I am seeing some kind of relaxed approach to life. Second thing, the meditation or the after effects of meditation brings in a certain degree of natural discipline. Like they get up at certain time of day, they go through their activities in an unhurried way, they don't get agitated all over, and generally they know the importance of time and time management. Generally they have a deep sleep after meditation, so that when they get up in the morning, you are alluding to the cortisol effect and how glucose pours forth from the liver when it is not supposed to. All that negative consequences get lessened as a result of meditation. I'm seeing the effect practically in most of the patients who are doing meditation sincerely. The meditation itself is just one process, but what happens after meditation is also equally important. If suppose somebody meditates for half an hour, naturally many people will experience some peace or calmness and something. Suppose if you're able to carry forth that kind of mental attitude throughout the day, during the course of your business or activity, retain some degree of calmness in your mind when executing some work, then it makes a big difference. Like I referred to a quote earlier, play like you work and work like you play. It brings in a certain lightness of mind in dealing with important things. You have to do perfectly, but at the same time not get overwhelmed by it. So that kind of attitude is easy to develop if you are exposed to a meditation technique and you are doing a meditation properly. This is one thing. Second, what I found, this natural discipline is very important, because suppose if as a doctor I go and tell you have to sleep at 10 o'clock, have 7 hours sleep to ensure that your early morning sugar doesn't go up, and you have to inject yourself 3 times a day with insulin, and you have to take this tablet, you have to go for half an hour walking, preferably 2 times a day. So every injunction that you put forth, every condition that you, every demand that you put forth on the patient, it's going to increase the stress level. But when we mentally compare the people who are doing meditation and people who are not doing meditation, now when you look back and think, I understand that people who are into some relaxation technique, some meditation, some spiritual background, they were able to take it with some sort of equanimity. Like, okay, it is a thing to be done. Let us do it. Let us do it cheerfully. So that attitude comes from some sort of spiritual background and spiritual training and spiritual discipline. So definitely it's something to be experienced and seen.
Right, right. That's very valuable, Dr. Ravi. Very, very valuable. Mr. Som Kumar, what I find is that with the spiritual training, with meditation, you have been able to take diabetes in your stride very well. So this has probably, I also want you to tell us how this has helped you in other walks of life, number one. And number two, I would like to hear from you how this has affected the people around you. Were you able to make difference to their lives as well because of your attitude, because of the happy disposition that you portray all the time? Has it made a difference to the lives of people around you as well?
Well, I don't take this disease in my stride.
Okay.
I take it as a friend.
Right.
And another thing is, at every stage, even when I started gathering information and started my gym, I started adding on to the same thing again and again. The reading has not stopped yet. The gym workout has gone into yoga also now. And lifestyle, diet and all, at every moment when I get an information like that, positive information, I add it to my lifestyle or whatever I'm doing. So that has helped a lot. And then you have the feeling, you have the jubilant feeling of getting evolution.
Right.
You are evolving by this disease. So naturally that has to be your friend only. You know, somebody is helping your evolution. How can you think that, you know, that person is a commitment or a load on you? So that is the way I take it. And to tell you about the family and the friends and all, my wife is a diabetic. Mm-hmm. So it's actually, so we talk about it a lot, and she's also meditating. Right. All the things that I am doing, he is also following. And like that, in my group, whoever is my friend and that particular thing, they also follow. They watch you and they just want to understand what is happening to you. And if somebody else is diabetic, they come and ask you, how can you be like this? You know, we are not like that. Then you give some information. Then they get inspired by it. So like right. that, it is a it, the life becomes totally different. It becomes right. very well disciplined, and you start challenging it every day, probably.
Yes.
And understanding the difficulties of other people, and you have a then you develop a tendency to help them because you have been enjoying the benefits of your knowledge or whatever it is. So you would like to help others by telling that, and out of that you get more happiness. So like that, it is a continuous flow of life. Where and again I'm telling you, this has made a difference in me. All these things probably I would not have done. I would have taken it casually, life itself, and I just enjoy it and go ahead, whatever it is. But now you are actually made to make your life more disciplined. And especially on like this, you know, on the meditation part of it also, I started gathering more and more information. And there are very, very fascinating information when you do meditation and when you combine science with that. Now, I'm touching quantum science. You know, that is where I go even for my disease.
Okay.
It says that, you know, everything that is being done in the whole universe is out of a field, quantum field. That is doing everything. Even medicine, if a doctor gives you medicine, according to quantum science, what they say is when doctor is giving a medicine to you, you are actually, if you responded positively, that information goes to the field and that field is actually giving the relief out of its potentiality.
Right.
So if you can connect there, whatever you want in life, it gives you. Only thing is, you have to match the vibration of that field. So that comes in meditation. And I'm trying it on my disease also.
Yeah.
You know, I'm just, that is where I talked about the negative part of the medicine and all. I'm just putting a thought there. You know, right. this negative part should not affect me.
Yeah. No, that is true. And this emphasizes the feeling that I've always had that science is actually far closer to spirituality than anybody ever thinks.
Yes.
So they're not mutually exclusive and they have to be in tandem with each other, work with each other.
Yeah, it's actually complementary.
Yeah, they're very complementary to each other. Yes, yes. All right. And so now let me go back to Jazz one last time before our time is up. Jazz, yours has been an incredible journey so far, and you have coped with it and dealt with it so very well. So I want you to give out a message to the children with type 1 diabetes and even adults with type 1 diabetes today about striking a balance between doing all that there needs to be done for type 1 diabetes in terms of monitoring, in terms of injections, etc., on the one hand, and behavioral issues and keeping up a positive attitude, doing what you can on the other side. So I want you to tell them how to strike that balance the way you have done.
So there's no denying that the type 1 life is a challenging life. It is difficult to take monitor your sugar 7 times a day, take insulin 4 to 5 times a day, the highs, the lows. It's a difficult life. There's no doubt about it, right? What I would say is that while having to do all of that, what I truly believe in, and at the Diabetes Foundation, what we try to do a lot is firstly focus on peer support, focus on people who've gone through what you've gone through, right? So lived experience gives you some sort of camaraderie that sort of pushes you on, right? A doctor, right, with all due respect, will tell you all the correct medical things, but only another type 1 will know what it feels like to get a hypo, right? So one is that. The other thing which I personally believe in, and I try to tell all our people with type 1, is to celebrate the small successes. I believe that type 1 is a life of small successes, and that reaps the bigger reward. So in a day, if you've checked your sugar one more time in the day, celebrate it. If your HbA1c has come down even 0.1 point, celebrate it. If you have sort of got a time in range day to day, celebrate it. These small successes are sort of what pushes you towards that bigger goal of good glycemic control. And I also like to keep saying is that it may be a bad day. You may have completely terrible sugars, but it's not a bad life. So I try to just reiterate that it may be a bad day, but it's not a bad life. And celebrate type 1, right, get out of the darkness and bring it into the light. I know so many cases of kids going into bathrooms and injecting because they're ashamed of their type 1. That's also because the taboos and stigmas that revolve around type 1 diabetes are, you know it, it's all around the place. And I think the lack of awareness about type 1 and type 2, I think it's diabetes is often just said as diabetes and the type is often not mentioned. And that also creates a lot of unawareness and taboo. So that forces kids to sort of hide. So I think being confident about your condition is by having your education, as Mr. Somkumar said, doing your own research, getting to know about your condition, being confident about it, and remembering that you're not alone in this journey. It may be a bad day, but it's not a bad life.
Right. Give some concluding remarks as being a diabetologist, endocrinologist that is dealing with both type 1 and type 2 persons with diabetes. And I'm also a person who is into some kind of meditation and spirituality. So, you know, seeing both sides of the story. So this has been an incredible journey that both Jazz and Mr. Somkumar have had, highly, highly inspirational. So it's very important to understand you have the physical part of dealing with diabetes. You have to keep checking your sugars. You have to take your medication. You have to do your diet. You have to do your exercise. All of that is there on one side. To do this on a daily basis, day in and day out, you require certain behavior skills. You require certain coping skills. And you require a spiritual mindset. And this is where I think meditation and spirituality comes in. So it's the perfect cementing between what you need to do and the outcomes that you desire. So spirituality, meditation on the one hand, and doing what you have to do for diabetes physically, these are not two mutually exclusive things. They are complementary to each other. And this is the holistic view of looking after diabetes. Do all that you need to do. And also at the same time, develop the coping skills in the form of meditation or spirituality to do so. On the part of doctors, if there are any doctors in the group, it is very insightful to understand that you need to be non-judgmental when you are dealing with patients with chronic disease like type 2 diabetes. So being non-judgmental also means at the same time being empathetic towards them and giving them these kind of tools rather than just looking at the technology and the pharmacological part of it, giving them the tools, the necessary information about coping skills, about behavior skills, wherein meditation and spirituality can come in so that you have an overall worldview of the disease where you will ultimately have better outcomes, less complications, less heart attacks, and a much, much better quality of life. So with this, I think we have come to the end of our time in this webinar of heartfulness, of wellness, and of type 2 diabetes as a prototype of a chronic metabolic disease. Thank you all for a very, very patient listening. And I hope that this has given all of you hope, especially for those people amongst you who have this chronic condition, that life is not over. In fact, a bigger life awaits you at the end of all of this. And it's a journey, it's a process, it's not an end in itself. So with these few words, I will sign off and say bye-bye to you at the end of this webinar. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The panelists.